My name is Dave Honorato. I'm a research scientist with the Fish and Wildlife Research Institute. I'm the head of research for the Florida Panther Project, and I'm based out of the Naples field office. In terms of panther research, the Naples field office has been down here since 1981. Just happened to be driving by this area where we are now, right on the doorsteps of the Picayune Strand State Forest, and noticed a piece of property that was for rent. 5 acres fenced in, great place for a field office, and the rest is kind of history. We've been here since 2009. Much better location than before, allows us to store all our equipment, and we're right in the mix of wildlife at the urban wildland interface in Naples. Panther Project's kind of unique in that the management and research sides of the project are both stationed in the same office and really work together as a team. Right now we have a total of 6 staff members, 4 for FWRI and 2 for HSC. Long-term monitoring of panthers has played a big role in our project for a long time, more than 40 years now. So we have these voluminous amounts of data from radio collars that we can use to answer a variety of questions on survival, cause-specific mortality, reproduction. We document litters from females using those radio collars and subsequently potentially get information on kitten survival. We also deploy GPS collars, which send us the data right to our desktop, sometimes in almost real time. I can't overstate the importance of that kind of data. Having information across multiple years is important to get at questions on conservation and recovery. Things that we're working on now would include looking at range expansion of panthers north of the Caloosahatchee River, which would be kind of the next step for panther conservation, is to have the population expand out of South Florida into Central Florida. With the arrival of feline leukomyelopathy, which is a neurological disorder that we documented in panthers and bobcats back in 2017, we've started to deploy like arrays of cameras in different parts of South Florida to see if we can get an idea of the prevalence and occurrence of that disorder in our wild felids. Bobcats obviously provide us an opportunity for a species to work with that's a little bit easier to handle than panthers. They're also not endangered and they're more common. So in theory, we may be able to get more information off them than panthers just because there's more of them out there. And since they're also being affected by FLM, we've recently attempted to start to try to capture them using traps. We've also released our rehabilitated bobcats and fitted them with radio collars so that we can monitor them. And if some of those animals start exhibiting signs of FLM, this could all feed into that big question of, you know, what is the root source of FLM? What is the cause of FLM? And that remains a mystery to us today. It continues to be our most pressing research objective to try to figure out what's behind this neurological disorder. You know, today we're at a population range of about 120 to 230 panthers, so in a much better place than we were in 1995 when we only had 20 to 30. And the population is genetically today much healthier than it was in 1995. So that's one of our continued objectives in terms of research, is every year we collect 20 to 40 samples from panthers, and so we can monitor the genetic health of the population. So one of the things I think that's kind of unique about the Panther Project here is the staff that we have. They're obviously very dedicated. People that take these positions are genuinely interested in trying to recover and conserve the Florida panther for the long term for all Floridians. I think we all get a sense of pride and joy from thinking that we're making a difference in keeping panthers on the landscape in Florida.